What is up, people? BP here. Welcome to the channel. If this is your first time, let me just be the first to say welcome. And yeah, this channel rocks because I cover quite a broad variety of subjects that deal with scripture and also things like Martyrs Mirror, which is a book written in the 1600s that details the lives of Christians from the time of Jesus Christ and the original 12 disciples all the way up until the 1600s. It was like, you know, Christians being persecuted for their faith under the Catholic Church, under different emperors and different kings and rulers in those days. And the Christians were very faithful to the end, and they suffered some very awful deaths. But today we're going to be doing something different. Today we're going to be looking at Dr. Peter Ruckman, this sermon right here. It is amazing. And if you've never heard of Dr. Peter Ruckman, he is perhaps one of the most popular and authoritative voices in the Christian realm, especially online, and especially when it comes to subjects like the King James Bible and other Baptist theology. But we're going to be looking at this particular sermon today. I cannot post the whole thing simply for copyright reasons, and I will likely put the link to this particular sermon in the description below. So if you would like a copy for yourself, please feel free. Purchase a copy and support the cause. Of course, not a single penny goes to myself for the purchase. This is simply for the benefit of you and also for anyone out there listening to my voice and watching this video. So yes, I do not profit one bit. I have a regular job. Hence the reason why I have a funny background. But that's okay. I hope to change that someday. But like you, it's a struggle to the top, man. Anyways, so I might provide some commentary on this video. I can only post about 10 minutes or so, maybe 15 minutes if I'm lucky. But yeah, make sure you guys get a copy for yourself. I will leave a link in the description. And also, I might just post some other material as well in the description, and that material will actually benefit me and the affiliate links. So if you want to help me out, or if you want to support this channel, you can do that, man. It'll be greatly appreciated. But anyways, maybe buy a new suit or something. But yeah, I hope you guys enjoy, and you guys take care.
Now, my subject tonight is why go on living. And I don't have any particular text. There are all kinds of texts in the Bible for it. I don't know whether you know it or not, but almost every man of God that ever did anything for the Lord was at one time or another seeking to blow his brains out. And I don't know how much Bible you read, but Moses one time asked God to kill him. And Elijah asked God to kill him one time. And Jonah said, I do well to be angry even unto death. And I think Paul was kind of a suicidal maniac. I mean, he kept saying, for to me to live is Christ, to die is gain. And he'd say to depart and be with Christ is far better. I've always thought that a fellow that lived as careless as he lived was trying to get his brain blown out. You take all that whipping he went through and all that stuff he went through, a man trying to live careful doesn't have that much happen to him.
Yeah.
And I figured he's trying to get on home to glory. Now, I don't know how many of you ever thought about blowing your brains out, but chance of 10 to 1, everybody in this building has thought about it one time or another. Now, maybe not. Maybe some of you younger folks haven't yet. And maybe I'm talking to some older folks that just life has just been a ball for you. At least you get put up with it. And so you didn't think about really blowing your brains out. But I think the thought has occurred to most Christians at one time or another. America has 40,000 suicides a year. There are 900,000 suicides yearly in the world. And the world's capital for suicides, many years ago, was Japan, and then Denmark, and then Austria. And now the world's suicide capital is Austria, and then the United States comes along about third. And I'm going to talk about why people commit suicide and why you shouldn't commit suicide. I don't recall there's any rate of suicide in Africa at all. There's a high rate in Asia and Europe, but as far as I know, Africans don't commit suicide, as far as I know. It's a strange thing. You take in America, the suicide rate in America is about one black for 50,000 whites.
How about
folks say the race are the same. You're just as rabid as a cockeyed rooster. You don't know what you're talking about. If it's the same, what's the deal on the average? Now you take, I worked years ago up in Rehoboth Beach, Delaware at a beach club up there called the Indian Beach Club. And that was Rehoboth Beach, Delaware, with all the rich folks from Washington, D.C. came down the weekend, all lived like the devil and swap wise. I bartended up there in that place, in swap wise right across the bar, and trade cars. I mean, you drive my Duesenberg home, and I'll drive your Pierce Arrow home. That's the kind of cars I had back in those days. And I laughed God in the daytime. My job at night was a drink checker. A drink checker was the guy who sat there and checked the order when it came in, checked the order when it went out, to make sure, nobody's getting a little sidekick. But by the end of the night, they'll all be drunk anyway. Yeah. I don't care how much you check the drinks going in and going out, then at night, all the waiters will be looped. And I used to sit on my stand there, and I had a guy working there out there on the beach, an umbrella boy named Jake. And Jake he was a graduate of Tuskegee Institute for colored people. He had an advanced degree. And that old boy was sharp as a whip. And he used to sit around there and moan and sing the blues to me out there in the lifeguard stand when I'm out there lifeguarding. And sometimes he'd cry, and I'd say, "What are you crying about?" He said, "Nobody accepts me." And I said, "What do you mean?" He said, "Well, I can't be with the white folks. The white folks don't accept me." And he said, "Moan folks." He said, "They're waiting at the table when the knights all over there back there shooting craps, and telling dirty jokes and stuff, and I can't do that." Maybe he's a Christian, I don't know. But he had the misfortune of being educated. And his buddies weren't educated. So nobody had them. White folks wouldn't have them, black folks wouldn't have them. Now, if there was such a thing as a candidate for suicide, I guess Jake might be a candidate for suicide. But you have to be educated to be a candidate for suicide. I mean, in the highest rate of deaths in college outside of car accidents is suicide. College students. Yeah. All right, I'm going to talk about that a while tonight. And of course, a lot of jokes about it. You have jokes about anything. Human nature as such can always find something to joke about. And they find a guy up there in the attic, with a rope tied around his waist. They say, "What are you doing?" He says, "I'm committing suicide." They say, "How are you going to do it tied around your waist? What did you tie around your waist for?" He said, "Well, I tried around my neck, but it was choking me." And I don't know whether or not you've ever taken out a razor, slit your throat with a straight edge razor, and looked at that thing, but that thing is sharp.
Yeah.
It's sharp.
Oh, yeah.
It'll hurt you.
Yeah.
Did you ever look down the muzzle of a 9mm gun with the safety off? That hole is so big. It's only 9mm. That thing looked like a 3 inches across.
Yeah.
Now, I know some of you never long been that road, but maybe you will before it's over. I don't know. And I've met very few Christian life that didn't, after they've been, saved 20 or 30 years, that didn't think about it. And some of them plan it. A lot more, talk about it than ever do it. Like a woman kept threatening to commit suicide, her husband, And he'd say, promises, all I get is promises, that's one of them things. They have jokes about them jumping off the buildings, and up there in the building, you got to go out and talk to them, and try to talk them out of it. And policeman comes out there and on the ledge, and talks to the guy, and says, "I'm going to kill myself." He said, "Well, I give you five reasons for staying alive." He said, "I give you five reasons for ending it." The cop said, "I'll tell you what you do, we'll take 5 minutes. And I'll give you 5 minutes why you should stay alive and you shouldn't jump, and you give me five reasons why you shouldn't. And by the time we're through, I'm sure I'll convince you." So he gave him five reasons why I ought to live, and the other guy gave him five reasons why they shouldn't. And at the end of it, both the man and the policeman jumped off the ledge. Then they have a joke down south about a guy who goes up there about to jump off the ledge, and they try to talk him out of it. They try all kinds of things. Remember your wife, I haven't got a wife. Well, remember your children. Well, I haven't got any children. Well, remember your health. I've been sick all my life, and I'm dying right now of cancer. Well, remember Robert E. Lee. And the guy says, "Who's Robert E. Lee?" And the guy says, "Go on, Yankee, jump." Oh, yeah. And you take Bob Newhart. Bob Newhart, he used to be funny. Bob Newhart's not very funny anymore. Back in the old days when he was a one-liner, a stand-up comedian, he had some pretty funny stuff. He'd run a monologue on a guy about to commit suicide. And he has this book on how to deal with suicides, and he's reading on what the instructions are on how to deal with suicide. You're supposed to approach them casually so as not to upset them, So he has this scenario where this guy's in the ledge ready to jump, and this guy's going to talk him out of it, comes up there and walks around the ledge and meets him on the ledge and says, "Hi there." The ledge, man. The guy says, "What are you doing?" And the fellow says, "Well, I'm just going to work, and this cat passed this way, and I walk along the ledge." He gets called. The guy says, "What are you, an advertising executive?" He said, "Did you handle the Edsel account?" That's back in the Depression. All those guys are jumping off the thing, you know. And he gets talking with him, among other things he gets talking about there. He tries to be casual about it, and he says, "Quite a crowd down there, isn't there?" He said, "You know, you'd be awful disappointed. They'd be awful disappointed if you didn't jump, you know, just talking to the guy." And he said, "There's Sam, the hot dog man down there. Sam, how about give us a couple of hot dogs?" No, to go, Sam, to go. Now, they have kind of jokes about it, but it isn't funny when it happens. You take a fellow in this town, I talked to him years ago. Must have been about 25 years, not maybe longer than that. And that old boy, his wife had left him, and he was already in the wheelchair. And he could move around a little bit, but couldn't walk. And there he was with nobody, had no children, and no place to go. And she just walked out of the house and left him in the house, and by himself. And I told him, I said, "The first thing you do is get out of this house. Get out in the fresh air or something, get some friends, if you got any friends, or contact some folks, or get out in the park and move around the sunshine, but get out of this house. I said, you've had all your trouble in this house, and this house is just going to depress you. And I said, you better get out of this house and stay out of this house." And he didn't do what I told him to do. And about 5 days later, they found him dead. He shot himself with a .22 pistol, shot himself 3 times, lying there on the floor, had to take 3 bullets to fend himself off. I think that guy'd be alive today if I told him what to do. But I told him what to do if he'd done it, but he didn't do it. He didn't do it. And you know, the thing about the suicide thing is a strange thing, but if your time hasn't come to go, you can't kill yourself anyway.
Amen.
I mean, you might think you can, but you can't.
That's right.
I mean, right here in this town, I've been with a guy in this town, put a .410 shotgun, you know, right up to his head and pulled the trigger, boy, and I'm in a buck. Double-aught buck in that thing and pulled that thing, and he was a vegetable for about 8 months before he finally died. But he didn't finish it off. And I've known guys take 38s, pull the thing, and the bullet hit the skull, go around the skull. Guy went in the hospital about 6 months, then he's out again, has to do the job over again. All right, now, in talking about why a person should go on living, there's some reasons why people want to end it all. And the first of these is bad health. Unless you've had real bad health, you may not understand what I'm getting ready to say. And I don't want
to... All right, guys. I know that was not a very long video. I do apologize. But I'm going to have to interrupt the video briefly just to give a little commentary, and then I could probably give you another 5, maybe 10 minutes of the sermon. And hopefully I won't get any copyright strikes because we love Dr. Peter Ruckman's preaching. Very good stuff. All right, so before we go any further, I just wanted to briefly show you this little group here on Facebook. This is Toxic Kings No Simpin' Future Lead the Way. All right, there's about 60,000 members. All right, and I'm one of them. And just to kind of give you a brief understanding of the type of humor that we have here, because this is going to help you to understand the story that I'm about to tell. I'm going to show you this little picture here. And here it is. It is a dog licking his butt crack and then proceeds to give a kiss on the lips of his owner. White people, this is a problem. Okay. Not only do white folks have a higher rate of suicide, but they also let their dogs kiss them on the mouth. That is disgusting. We need to do better, okay? All right, so I wanted to tell you a little story about this group here to kind of illustrate the type of humor that people typically have towards the concept of suicide, okay? As you can see, Dr. Peter Ruckman was trying to make light of it, you know, because it is a serious subject, and anytime people talk about it, it becomes a bit too serious. And honestly, it's good to kind of add some humor in there, because it's a major problem, especially in the United States. He said upwards of like 40 something thousand people I've read statistically that just among veterans alone, I think it's way more than that. And matter of fact, I think in just in one state, it's like 30,000. Like veterans take themselves out more than any other group of people. And anyway, so about this group, so this particular individual came into this group, which I'm actively involved in, and he was like, hey, you know, I'm experiencing some trouble, you know, I'm having bad thoughts, you know, I'm thinking about dying, I want to die, life sucks. And instead of the guys in the group saying, hey, man, don't worry, it's going to be okay, like supporting him and encouraging him and uplifting him, they were like, nah, man, just go ahead and take yourself out. They were just like absolutely brutal in how they were dealing with him. And I couldn't quite understand why guys were like that. Now, if you go to a different group, like I've got a couple other groups that I'm a part of, all right, where there's more women, okay, women are more sympathetic. They're like, you know, hey, it's going to be okay. All right. The difference is the men, yes, they might be, you know, I guess crude about it or obvious with it. They actually don't want you to die. Okay. They're a bit more supportive, even though they sound like bullies, even though they sound like jerks. Okay. The women on the other hand, oh, they might sound like, oh yeah, you know, it's going to be okay. They're actually hoping that you're going to die. They're probably thinking in their minds that, you know what, life would be better without you. You know, let's see if this really happens. Okay. So if you're a guy and you struggle with depression, I would highly suggest not going to a group of women who are going to help you to quote unquote feel better, even though they really don't care about you, man. They don't care about your problems. Okay. They want to see if you're actually going to die. The guys, however, they do want you to survive. They do want you to pull through. They might just bust your chops a little bit about it. And that was the point I wanted to kind of make, that even though Peter Ruckman might crack jokes about this sort of subject, he actually does care. Okay. And that was the point of the sermon. If you go and listen further into the sermon, he gives reasons why you should not take yourself out. Okay. And I would say that the number one reason is because you do not know what's on the other side of death's door. Okay. There's a door, what we call death's door. Okay. And beyond that, what's on the other side of that door is the unknown. Okay. Now, for Christians like myself, we believe that it's either heaven or hell, paradise or torment. Okay. Now, a lot of people believe that when you die, especially if you die by your own hands, you're not going to go to paradise. You're going to go straight to the fire. Okay. So this is what we would call jumping from the pan into the fire. Okay. You're going from a bad situation, which might be temporary. Okay. Depending on if it's health reasons or family or relationship reasons, and you're jumping into a far worse situation. Okay. A reason to not take yourself out. Okay. So no matter what you're going through in life, yes, it might suck. Yes, it might be horrible, but Jesus said, he that endures to the end, the same shall be saved. Okay. What's 50 years of suffering versus 500 million. Okay. There's no comparison. So it's better to just deal with the problems as they are for the temporary life that you have than to deal with them in a far worse and unpredictable circumstance. Okay. So that's pretty much all I have for you at the moment. And like I said, let me go ahead and see if I can put a few more minutes in of his preaching so you guys can enjoy that.
Understand what I'm saying. That is, I don't have you think that I'm a favor of suicide, or whenever I say something, somebody's always sitting there waiting to twist it. I never opened my mouth. There wasn't somebody sitting there just as with their codfishy nerve, just sensitive enough to have a fit, yeah, and just waiting to get offended. Ruckman believes in abortion. How many ever heard that? Let me see your hands. There's 50 hands. Ruckman believes in divorce. How many ever heard that? Let me see your hands. Another 50. That stuff is lies. Those are lies. Ruckman recommends suicide. Shut your mouth, you crook. That stuff, that's a bunch of little jealous, backslidden preachers God hasn't used in 50 years and not going to use in the next 50 years. I don't recommend suicide, but if you're in pain all day long, day and night, night and day, you think about it. You will think about it. Some of these doctors carve so much on people, they ought to be called Mac the Knife. And I bet some Christmas carved on so much, I think they ought to be called Turkey. I mean, we had a lady in our church one time over there in Brent, and she'd had 24 operations in 22 years, I think. 24 operations. Now, brother, you talk about getting you down and giving you the mully grubs. Boy, that'll do it. And you take bad health, of course, sometimes. We had a lady here in this town one time. She's a widow, and she left with a 14-year-old boy who was a paralytic. God took her husband and took her healthy boy and left with a 14-year-old boy who was a paralytic in a wheelchair. And that old boy, in the wheelchair, he was saved. And the mama wasn't saved. And after she lost her son and her husband, she wanted to commit suicide. She tried to get the boy to commit suicide with her. And he said, I don't want to commit suicide. And she said, why not? He said, I've got something to live for. I'm enjoying life.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
And he talked his mom into getting saved.
Yeah. Yeah.
But bad health can work on you. If you never had it, you wouldn't understand the thing. Now, you take in the Bible, there are five suicides in the Bible. Zimri commits suicide. Saul commits suicide. Ahithophel commits suicide. Samson commits suicide. Judas commits suicide. Those people all commit suicide. Saul, Ahithophel, Zimri, Samson, and Judas. And because that, people think, well, a suicide can't be saved. But that's Catholic teaching. That's nonsense.
That's right. Yeah.
They say, well, adultery, you know, is a mortal sin, you know, and suicide is a mortal sin. They don't know what they're talking about. Samson pulls the house in down on himself and says, let me die with the Philistines, and dies with the Philistines, and he goes down as one of the heroes of faith in the book of Hebrews.
That's right.
So Ruckman believes it. See, this is how people are. They just sit there and just waiting to grab it. It isn't what Ruckman says, what that book says.
Amen.
That book puts him down one of the hill. That shows a man can be a suicide and be saved.
Amen.
Now, I'm not recommending it. You get told like this. People there, who are these? I think they're hanging around the television so much that their mind are just all full of bees and flies. Bees. They come and sit here, a preacher preach, they don't hear what he's saying.
Yeah.
It's just bees. Yeah. I heard one time he said this, one time he said this, the last time he said this, I heard him say bees. Better go stick your head in the bucket of Clorox about 3 hours and put it in three times, pull out twice, get your brain cleared out, boy, and get the wax out of here.
I've got to say this, I'm sorry for interrupting. I really am. If it wasn't for the copyright, I really would not interrupt at all. But I was laughing my head off the first 10 minutes of his sermon. I was like busting so hard. I was trying not to make a noise because, yeah, my microphone will pick up that noise like it's picking up my AC noise in the background. But I don't have a way to like turn the gain down. But anyways, my goodness, man, he is like, if he wasn't a preacher, he would have made a great comedian. Like, dang, man. But yeah, so this is like such a serious topic, but it's incredible how he's able to add humor to it, and it's like, what the heck. But anyways, yeah, let's go ahead and let him finish, and got a few more minutes. I can let him talk for a few more minutes, and then I'm gonna have to stop this, and yeah, you guys will just have to go purchase the whole sermon separately. So here we go.
Thank you, brother. Appreciate that word testimony. And I'll tell you something else. And like I say, if you've never really had trouble with that kind of stuff, you might not be able to understand why people do a thing like that. But I've talked to people, it was a marvel to me, they didn't commit suicide in the condition they were in. And I'm not saying the Bible approves up, I'm not saying it's right, but that's one reason why people commit suicide. It's bad health. I tell you the reason why they commit suicide. They commit suicide because they're worrying about the future.
Yeah.
You know why Hitler committed suicide? He knew what was coming. He knew if they got him, they'd put him in a cage, and they would have, and take him around the world and exhibit him in different countries and charge money to see him. That's what they'd have done. And he knew it. He wasn't going to let them do it. You know what? You know why Himmler committed suicide? He knew what would happen if he didn't commit suicide. You take Goering, he knew what would happen. You have to walk up the 13 steps and hang by the neck, a dishonorable death, so he just took poison and got out of it the easy way. Folks worry about the future. And the future is something to worry about if you're unsaved.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't know who holds the future, but I know who holds my hand.
Amen.
And out of the God of the present, the God of the future, and the God that saved me, he knows what's going to take place next. And these folks are worried about the atom bomb blowing us all to hell. It may blow them to hell. It's going to blow me to heaven anyway.
Yeah.
Somebody caught a nuclear bomb going off. Let her rip, brother. Flip a switch.
Yeah. Amen.
That's the kind of thing these humanists can't stand. Oh, think about the poor people. You ain't thinking about the poor people. You're thinking about yourself.
Yeah.
I never met one of these rich Democratic senators in my life who worried about anybody but his own skin.
Yeah.
He just asked, like, oh, the poor minorities, the poor downtrodden folks in the ghetto, or the poor folks, give me your money, give me your money, give me your money. That fat cat, he's making $80,000, $100,000 a year. Worry about the folks. Why don't you pass a law that every man who's a senator has to tithe his income to downtown New York? That'd be gooder, wouldn't it? How about the president? 20% of your money goes to downtown Houston. That'd be a good one. You're so worried about those folks. Hey, man, get in there and help them out. I mean, you believe in integration? Move in there with them, man. Yes, sir, boy. Yes, sir, man. Marry you on, go right out in town, move right in with them, boy. Man, live it, boy. Hey, man, practice what you preach. Amen.
He is so right, too, man. All these leftists, these liberals, they make you think that they really care about the poor. They don't care one iota about the poor, man. it's the ones you least expect, okay? It's the people that actually value Christianity, the Bible, okay? Those are the ones that actually care about the poor, man. Oh, man. He's on fire right now, bro. He is absolutely on fire. We've got 2 minutes left, and let's go ahead and let him finish.
Brother, amen, amen, amen. I didn't mean to get this far off this message tonight, but I'm going after a while. They're worried about the future. You take Socrates, that Frisco faggot fruit. You take Socrates. He took hemlock and killed himself before his trial came. He knew what would happen at his trial. You say, what happened at his trial? Just what happened to Oscar Wilde when he got tried. Oscar Wilde, he was pink. He was just queer as a $3 bill. And when he got tried, all this stuff came out, all this personal stuff and all this gruesome, filthy, obscene stuff. Socrates knew that stuff would come out if he got tried. So he took hemlock and sacrificed a rooster for his sins and died, went on home to hell. You know what people do? They worry about the future. They worry about the future. They can't stand the thought of the future. And thinking about it just worries them to death. In the Great Depression, you know, a lot of people got deep in debt and bad in debt. A lot of the businessmen got in bad trouble. It was, married to Uncle Sam, till debt do us part. And a lot of them couldn't take a light attitude toward it. Some of them would just say, well, you know, just charge it the dust, let the rain settle it. But a lot of them couldn't do that. They took it seriously, and they blew the brains out. There was Fleischmann. That's Fleischmann Yeast Company. He drowned himself in the Pacific Ocean. There's Eastman. You know Eastman Kodak Company? Killed himself. Ivan Kruger, the Match King, he set up false banks, he forged signatures, he put up false accounts, he loaned $1,000 to European countries, and when the Depression came, the bottom broke out, he saw what he was going to face, he blew his brains out. I mean, Bush beer, is that the king of bottled beer, or is that something else? Or is it Miller? What's the king of bottled beer? I don't know, I haven't had a beer for 4 years.
I think it's, what is it, Budweiser? The ones that love the transgenders? Oh, man. All right, guys, I think that's it for today. You guys enjoy. God bless. I'm BP signing out.